Jared's got to look pretty for the camera.
Dude, I'm just not fucking dealing with this shit today. Fuck you guys.
Got to look pretty for the camera. Jared, I don't think we have time for you to get plastic surgery, though, to look good enough.
All right, welcome back to another edition of Miller Sound Off. I am your host. Thanks, Blaine. Glad you jumped in. Obviously, I'm your host, Mike Brown. You hear Blaine in the background. We got Jared and Big Kev, the usual suspects here. Big show for you guys tonight. Obviously, right now, the NBA draft is going on. First time that that Jared is excited about the NBA and his team not making mistakes. So we'll talk about the NBA draft, the NBA trades, kind of eyeing some potential trades. We've touched on in previous episodes, the Suns, Chris Paul. We'll do some NFL reactions, surprises, letdowns, and then we will get into our sound off. Gentlemen, how are we tonight?
I am relieved. My heart rate is slowly declining. I did not want us to draft LaMelo Ball. For those of you who don't know, I'm obviously a Minnesota Timberwolves fan. And I have been praying for the last 2 months, or a month, whenever we found out we were getting the number one overall pick, that we would get Anthony Edwards. So I'm very happy this morning. The best pro comp I heard from my boy Kev found this was his ceiling is D-Wade, his floor is Deion Waiters, in between is DeMar DeRozan. I'm happy with 2 out of 3 of those. So I'm very happy, guy, this morning. I love Edwards' game to begin with. I think it was the best fit for Minnesota because D-Lo is kind of – Russell and Towns have their very distinct styles, and Edwards is kind of an amoeba when it comes to his offensive style. So it really kind of – fits well with what they have. Wiseman going to Golden State was perfect for them. It kind of scares me a little bit because I think he's – besides Edwards, I think 1, 2, and 3 are the 3 best players in the draft, obviously, at least right now. Wiseman, I think, fits Golden State perfectly because of the fact that he can stretch the floor, his ability. Like, he with Golden State stretching the floor – he will have so much room to operate down low, and the fact that they're still trying to get rid of Draymond Green definitely is going to help his development because he's going to be their main man down below.
I don't know why you're scared. It's not like the Timberwolves are going to be seeing Golden State late in the playoffs anytime soon. Also, I think there is some concern to be had with those comparisons. You need to shoot the 3 to be successful in today's NBA. Minnesota doesn't have a lot of good 3-point shooters. That doesn't fix that issue.
I mean, Edwards isn't a bad 3 shooter, though. He was a decent shooter at Georgia.
Yeah, and Ben Simmons was a decent shooter at LSU.
Ben Simmons is also just a basket case. What do you want me to tell you?
Blaine, I know you're just jumping in. You're not the biggest basketball guy. I'm a Pistons fan this year. I'm excited.
I'm so sorry.
Yes, I know. They went point guard with the number 7 pick. 6'5 point guard out of France. I'll take that. That was a need, a position that we needed. Obviously, a lot going on with the Pistons. We got the Blake contract. Lots of overhead as far as money and stuff like that. So it's definitely something we need. Hopefully a guy that can come in and fill a role right away and play be productive for the Pistons. So I'm definitely looking forward to that. I know that there's been quite a few picks since then. Still obviously some talent on the board. Obviously, by the time this is released, it'll be all said and done. But overall, kind of excited. Blaine, have you really been able to touch base, tune in on any of the draft yet?
To be honest with you, no. We were just talking about it a couple hours ago. We got Ariza too, didn't we?
Yeah.
In a trade for 6.
No, I don't know. Actually, to tell you the truth, I saw pick. That come across, and I thought it was a potential trade for a number.
No, I think Ariza did go. But you guys didn't even give him a first-round pick. You guys gave him a future first-rounder.
Right.
Well, I saw something come across. Yeah, it was a potential. Based off of it, I don't know. Honestly, I'll look it up right now. That tells you how ill-prepared I am for basketball season, unfortunately.
Trevor Ariza in the 16th overall pick for a future first.
That's why. Okay, I saw that come across the bottom. I didn't know if that was – okay, either way. So we'll take it, I guess, at this point. in general. I saw, like I said, I saw that scroll across as far as based off of the before the Pistons actually picked. And I didn't know if it was like potential, but that shows how little I was paying attention. But with the NBA draft going on, we're talking about obviously trades as well. Mentioned Ariza, that's how ill prepared I am tonight. Obviously the big news, Houston. We talked about it last week. We talk about it again this week. Now Houston's straight up coming saying that they're prepared to just let these guys essentially rot and be unhappy. Do you think this happens into the season? This actually happens, and they're not gonna. I mean, honestly, Houston has all the leverage. These guys have no leverage whatsoever. So, do you think there is any potential that, unless they get exactly what they're asking for, that either Westbrook or Harden are moved?
I think Westbrook has a better chance of being moved. I could see him being moved before the season starts. It was reported they were talking to the Wizards about potential move.
Him and actually, not to cut you off, but him and I can't even think of it right. Jeez,
can't even think of it. Cuts me off. Him and John Wall are one for one. Yes. Is what the Wizards wanted.
Dude, just kind of like a swap.
However, with Wall's injury history and recent injury history, because Westbrook's also been hurt a couple times, the Rockets wanted more, and the Wizards said no. And then the two other teams that are looking at Westbrook are the Hornets, because Michael Jordan loves him, and the Knicks, because they have nobody. I can see him getting moved before Harden, because Harden, at this point in his career, is still a cornerstone piece of a team. Westbrook's not. He's kind of past that point. And as he gets older, his athleticism is only going to deteriorate more. I do think the Rockets are shooting themselves in the foot because their owner is saying he will not trade with Daryl Morey, and Philly could arguably give the best pick or the best return for that. But
I just – how fitting would it be for probably the most value, like you said, would be Harden. But it'd be a lot harder to come by that. I don't think many people want to mess with Westbrook or his contract, but leave it up to the Knicks. Obviously, it's not happened, but leave it up to the Knicks to land somebody like this to potentially him end his career in the Knicks or with the Knicks. You know, how fitting would that be to go to a dumpster fire of an organization? Yes, I am a Pistons fan. We've missed the best 9 out of 11 years. I get that, but as long as the Knicks are part of the NBA, the Pistons fans will have some kind of hope. So that's what I can see happening, seeing him go to the Knicks. Jared, what do you think? Either of these guys get moved? Do you even think there's a snowball chance in hell that Harden could even end up in Brooklyn?
Okay, well, we talked about this last night with me and Kevin's buddy and former Belly Up writer Peter Mitchell about this a little bit. And at the same time, one, I love the Knicks draft pick of Obi Toppin, and I think it fits with the RJ Barrett move. I think they're setting themselves up to make a trade for a point guard. I love like what the Knicks honestly back to back years have made good picks at their position. I love Toppin's game. If Minnesota didn't get a top five pick, he was who I hoped we'd get because he's a good power forward. He's got a good game. He's very athletic, great defender. Out of Dayton, obviously, and with the Knicks, though, I love Westbrook to the Knicks. I made this point last night. What a better way to get all these young guys who need shots than a guy who needs to get 10 assists tonight. A guy who likes to just drive the basket and kick out to open shooters. I think Westbrook to the Knicks now with Toppin there as well makes a ton of sense. I think Russ would love it with his fashion, with the whole fashion thing he tries to do and everything else. It's his team. And how fitting would it be for Russell Westbrook to somehow lead the Knicks to like an 8 seed in the playoffs with that crew? Because that's not a bad supporting cast. You put
0% chance that happens.
Oh, God. Yeah. Kevin, I love your optimism.
If I were a young player on the Knicks, I would hate I would hate trading for Westbrook because let's say it's a close game against the Cavs because that's probably the only team they can run with in the NBA right now, or the Hornets. Westbrook's gotten his 10 assists in the third. I'm not seeing the ball the entire fourth quarter because Westbrook's going to try and play hero ball to win the game, and we're going to lose.
I still love the concept, though. I think it fits, and for Westbrook, it's what he wants. He wants the fashion brands. He's at Tom Ford fashion shows and shit. He's not about, like, playing in a small market, New York would be a dream scenario for him. He'll probably be like, Houston, make this deal happen. Give me RJ Barrett, who can honestly sit on the corner and hit threes and mid-range jumpers for a while. Obi Toppin, who can play defense on the back end. I think it makes sense. Do I think they're going to be better than a 7th or 8th seed? Probably not. In the East, it's possible, though, because the back end of the East is still garbage.
Speaking of which, right?
So your selling point is because he's high fashion, like Zoolander.
Well, no, it's
the reason why it makes sense.
Well, no, it makes sense also for the game, his style of game. It makes also for style of game, but like his off the court shit, it makes total sense. On top of that, that's just a bonus. The off the court shit's a bonus. On the court, I mean, Russell Westbrook really doesn't fit truly with anybody. His game is kind of self-destructive, but at the same time, for what it is right now, the best fit would be a team with a bunch of guys who just want open shots. So,
yes, that is, and like I said, just coming in, granted, by the time this airs, it'll be the point will be mute, but the Pistons just traded with, well, actually, it was a three-way trade with the Clippers. It looks like the Clippers, the Nets, and the Pistons, Pistons send Luke Kennard. Looks like the Nets get the number 19 overall pick. And trading Landry Shamet. Yes, big news coming through. That's the Woj bomb for tonight. But yes, you can tell how upbeat and exciting it is basketball season for us. We usually talk about football and stuff like that. So let's transition. I know.
Wait, did you guys see the it just happened tonight. Did you see the Sixers Lakers or the Sixers Thunder trade?
Oh boy.
Al Horford, first and a second for Danny Green.
Huh?
It's awesome. The Sixers are so bad. Oh my god.
The sheer that's what is like. You compare apples to oranges. I get it, but you would think drafts in general, you know, to have the number one pick, you're looking at okay, a plethora of talent. Same thing with the NBA. You have a plethora of talent, but this year I feel like there was no one clear cut. Nobody really wanted that number one pick because anybody outside of the 3, 4, 5, 6 pick was still going to get a lot of talent that could have eventually hyped up to been that number one pick, where we talk about the NFL and it seems like they're leaps and bounds ahead. You know, it's just, I guess it's just a different ball game. But yeah, you see more number one picks traded in the NBA for Danny Green.
No, it wasn't the number one pick. It was just a first round pick.
Well, for, I'm sorry, not the number one.
But oh, okay. Pick, yeah.
But yeah. In general, you don't even see that in the NFL, the first round picks swap that much.
The reason for it also was, it's because the talent pool is a lot smaller in the NBA, I feel. Less guys on the team. Even though there's more good teams in college, there's less guys on the team. But the reasoning was Al Horford was set to make $28 million this year, and Danny Green set to make $14.
Sorry, there's
also, Al Horford's family is so happy that he's out of Philly.
Did you see what she tweeted?
Was it his wife or his sister? A lot of people get that confused. Was it Anna Horford?
It's his sister. Yeah.
A lot of people get that confused. I haven't seen his wife tweet much. So I knew his sister did. Yeah, she probably tweeted something about it. His brother, Josh, said, thank God he's out of Philly. We love Boston. And it was so weird going from their Twitter to the crybaby Philly Twitter.
As a member of Philadelphia Sports Twitter, I will say we are the fucking worst. So, yeah, no, I will back up that statement.
I don't know. Like, we've got two of them on this show right now. Boston and Philly. I'm not saying you guys, but Twitter. I can tell you that Boston.
Boston Twitter is just angry. Philly Twitter is whiny and angry.
Boston acts like they are owned everything because they haven't seen a title in what 3 years or 2 years, whatever it is. I don't know.
Don't talk about it. I'm still sad.
Yes,
it's sad when a small market team can't win because they can't.
But
spend
anyways,
money.
Moving on from basketball to NFL, we'll get Blaine's input in this now that things are moving on. NFL reactions. Obviously, we're past the halfway. Well, I guess depending on how the season works out, you know, we're kind of past the halfway point. A lot of things are shaping up. The playoffs have been expanded this year. We've got the the NFC least. That is still anybody's ball game. Jared is I wouldn't even say a bandwagon fan. He's driving that bus right now. Surprises, letdowns. Give me two. We'll start with you, Blaine. Give me two of your biggest surprises in the NFL and two of your biggest letdowns. It could be individual players, it could be individual teams. I know we're just kind of winging it right now, but what are you thinking right now? Two of your surprises this year.
That's a good question. I to be honest with you, I'm actually a fan of the NFC least because it's exciting to watch bottom of the barrel teams go at it. Excellent. So I mean, I like that, but I mean, Tampa Bay with all the loaded talent that they got. I mean, I'm surprised that they're actually doing halfway decent.
It would have taken a little more. Granted, they got schlacked by the Saints, but I figured they would have had to kind of grow into it, throwing Antonio Brown into the mix and all of his debacle now with the security camera and the bicycle and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I thought it would take a little bit to get going, but it's kind of to be expected. Letdowns, you know, what are you thinking, Blaine? I mean, like I said, you can talk about individual players, a fantasy perspective. We got Zeke, obviously Dak being out. You know, I mean,
the biggest letdown is like Dallas Cowboys, like just basically losing their quarterback and then instantly becoming nothing. I have Zeke for fantasy football and like legitimately just feed him the rock, just do something. But he's being a letdown because he's not even being used.
He's the number one. I saw ESPN reported last week. He's the number one shopped player this year with no response, essentially nobody making the trade. The number one trade was Justin Herbert, actually. So that was kind of funny.
I actually got Justin Herbert in a trade, which is hysterical. So that's funny as fuck.
So Jared. Go ahead, Billy.
I was going to say that, I mean, a bigger surprise would for me, just because now I have him on my team, is Joe Burrow. I mean, rookie quarterback, offensive line is mediocre at best, but he's slinging the rock. And then I got Higgins as part of my wide receiver crew too, but he's doing wonderful, wonderful things for Cincinnati too.
I think the overall rookie quarterback class this year has been outperforming. You know, I think everybody's performed up to a higher standard than expected. He's had his chance, obviously. Herbert thrown in there. Everybody's got their opportunity. Burrow was expected to start. You knew there'd be growing pain. So it'd be interesting to be their sophomore season, how that works out. But I've got one that nobody – well, obviously, we're not all the way around yet, but I've got one that nobody's touched on yet. But, Jared, what you got? Give me two of your surprises and two of your letdowns.
All right, so two surprises. One, I got to give a nod to my boy. As much as Kev hates me talking about Eagles all the time, I got to give a nod to, like guys like Travis Fulgham. Like, this dude was an undrafted free agent and has been the Eagles' leading receiver. He's currently right now ranked by PFF as one of the best year two receivers overall, which is in a loaded class of back-end talent. It's great. But my biggest surprise is the Oakland Raiders. Like, holy shit. Like, they're a good team. And, like, every week we try to write them off, Cocaine Chucky comes back with, like, a win. And Nelson Aguilar, as much as I wish the man luck, into him in Miami, and he was talking shit about the Eagles. And I'm like, you know what? I don't feel bad. Sometimes a bad divorce happens. He's playing well. Like, I mean, I wish Ruggs played more because, like, I want to see that man speed on show. But Darren Waller is top three tight end. He replaced Zach Ertz, by the way. Josh Jacobs, living up to his year two hype. Him and Miles Sanders, by the way, talk about year two running backs living up to their standards the next year over. Like, I'm very impressed with both of them. Sanders averaging over 6 yards a carry. Josh Jacobs is just taking, like, I think he leads the NFL in carries, and he's just producing numbers. Disappointments. First, number one, is the Baltimore Ravens. Like, what the fuck? I'm sorry. Like, they should have four losses, okay? If it wasn't for two bad Doug Peterson play calls, they'd have another one.
So what's the disappointment?
Yeah, but no, they're barely winning. That's the problem. They're not blowing teams out like everyone thought they were. They're not the dominant team that some certain, America's favorite hosts, like Colin Coward, like, they're going 16-0. Kevin, I don't care if you're checking your watch.
Oh no! I got a notification.
I thought you were being your usual self. All right.
No.
Okay, so the Baltimore Ravens, guys, like, we thought this team was going to be stacked, and Kevin made a great point to me, and I will give him credit here. He said, Jared, there's nobody on the back end of that defense. And I'm like, oh, shit, you're right. There's no safety. The problem is they have great corners, but the back end middle of that defense, they're missing Earl Thomas, and you could see it when they play teams. And Lamar Jackson is my other disappointment. I'm doubling up because he has regressed. It's bad. The Patriots made him look like a rookie on Sunday night. And I'm just, and that, yes, that's, some of that is just Bill Belichick, but when I watched him in, like, I watched him live against my team, the one thing I was worried about was him running. I did not, once he dropped back, I'm like, oh, we're straight. We're good. There's no problems here. Because his accuracy's dipping. I'm not worried about him throwing the ball deep. I don't know if it's just Harbaugh pulling the chains, like, holding him back too far, or if he just wants to, like, you know, he's just afraid to throw it downfield, but for Lamar Jackson and the Ravens, I'm doubling up here on my disappointments because we were told all year this team was the best team in the AFC, and now I don't even know if they're going to be like a 4 or 5 seed in the playoffs. I'd pick it Indianapolis over them. I would, because that defense is, they got Baltimore, like, capitalized on a bullshit interception by Marcus Peters, and that's the only reason they won that game. The momentum shifted. And it just, that's how the game goes. That's football. But I don't know. The Baltimore Ravens, to me, just, I'm doubling up on them because they were like my Super Bowl pick for the AFC, and they are awful right now.
Didn't somebody on this show a year ago when we were talking about how good Lamar Jackson was, that basically said with 1 year of prep that the teams would figure out what exactly is going on with the offense?
And that I feel like that would.
I almost feel like if we could pull the clip, I'm almost positive that you guys had the exact conversation about that.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm not going through a year's worth of sound off.
No, you don't have to, but we've had this argument. Like, the reason why you're not successful
mentioned that before
is Lamar Jackson under pressure, under review, doesn't do well. He's not a great passer. He's a great runner. Doesn't make great decisions, and then the supporting cast doesn't support it.
Yeah. I mean, also, Lamar Jackson, the Ravens decided this year that they wanted to make Lamar Jackson a pocket passer in a year without much of a training camp, in a year without OTAs, which is the dumbest thing they could have done. But
I agree.
Yeah, so, Kev, where are you at? Surprises, letdowns?
I am shocked. I have a lot of surprises out this year. I'm going to keep it to 2. I'm surprised, Blaine or Jared, you haven't mentioned yet, the Pittsburgh Steelers.
Fair enough.
No one pictured them going under. Up to this point, I'm not saying they're going 16-0. But no one thought they were going to – everyone thought they were, you know, going to be pushing for a wild card spot where the Ravens were going to outpace them. People thought the Browns were going to be ahead of them in standings. And Pittsburgh's falling out. Colin Cowherd, too, so shut your mouth. They're falling out. Their defense is playing very well, and their offense is good enough to get it done. James Conner has had a pretty good bounce-back year after last year. He's not great, but he's good enough. Juju's not an embarrassment like he was last year. He's not good, really, but he's fine. And then also, my other surprise is Damian Harris. I'm not necessarily surprised that he can do this. I'm just surprised the Patriots are giving him the ball enough for him to do this. I mean, he was on IR for the first 3 weeks. He got, against Denver, that whole offense was terrible. He had 6 rushes for 19 yards. Against San Francisco, the whole team was awful. 10 rushes for 58. But otherwise, I mean, against Kansas City, week 4, 17 rushes, 100 yards. Against Buffalo, 16 carries, 102 yards. Against the Jets, 14 carries, 71 yards. Against Baltimore, this past weekend, 22 carries, 121 yards. This guy's a baller. I loved him. I loved this draft pick for the Patriots. And it's paying off now that they have to run the ball more. It's showing that maybe stockpiling okay running backs works because you can develop them.
Obviously, Kevin's a Bama fan. And I don't want to go into that, but
I mean, I will admit I love Damian Harris's game, I love him
as a person too. He's a wonderful human being. He came into my work once after he was going to a bar and it started pouring, so he came into my work and he was. I didn't like. I was like, oh my god, you're debuting here? No, I was like, okay, I'll be fine. He's 8 hours waiting here to stop raining. But he's very polite, very nice. But then my biggest disappointment, Jared's gonna yell at me. It's Carson Wentz. Say what you want about the it's Carson Wentz and Doug Peterson. Say what you want about the injuries, but every time a player goes down, I have to deal with this motherfucker saying, well, the next guy up's great. Like, he's phenomenal. We found our next guy. Well, then why aren't the results? Carson Wentz holds on to the ball too long. That's why he has so many sacks. That's why he has so many fumbles. He tries to play hero ball, which he has to get beat out of him. Literally beat out of him. They need to take two socks of the soap in the locker room and just hit him next time he throws a pick. Like, but that's
full metal jacket?
Yes, exactly. And it's not all on him. It's also Doug on third and short, when they're going to be sending pressure, he goes, hey, our quarterback's got glass bones and paper skin. Let's call a four verts, see what happens. What are you doing, Doug?
Oh, my God. See, this is what I deal with every day, even after the show's freaking over. No, I was going to put Doug Peterson as my other disappointment, but Lamar Jackson to me has been more disappointing to me. Doug Peterson needs to relinquish his play calling duties. It's been dead obvious. He's a great head coach. He's not a great play caller. Clearly, Frank Reich was calling the plays. Everyone knew it. And the thing is, Frank Reich now is in Indianapolis keeping that franchise afloat, because I swear to God, no other coach could pull this off. But I don't know. Honestly, I could chug beers for hours hearing Kevin bash my Eagles, but it's whatever.
I don't bash them too much because you get whiny, and I don't want to deal with that.
I get annoyed, not whiny. You're an irritant.
So, no, like I said, I was listening to a thing, and they were talking about, at this point, outside of Eddie Lacy and Trent Richardson, you're pretty much, as a GM, you might as well draft the first, the second, and the third string running back for Alabama every year, because that has panned out at least the past couple years. You know,
yeah, I mean,
because Harris, I mean, who was, what was he, the number two or what was he?
He was, his freshman year, he backed up Derrick Henry, and then he kind of became the number one for a bit, and then Najee Harris his last year, so he split carries with him. I think a better example of that is Josh Jacobs. Josh Jacobs was a special teams guy at Alabama. He played a little bit on offense more his last year, but mostly just special teams, and then he still got drafted in the first round because he had that much talent.
Tagovailoa, clean pocket, flips it in the flat. There goes Jacobs. Head of steam, lowers the shoulder and scores. It is perfect.
So
that's insane.
I didn't know that. My I'll go with my biggest surprises. I'll just throw you one out here that you know, you guys talked about Pittsburgh. My big surprise is, I feel like every year for the past 3 years on Belly Up Sound Off, we've always kind of anointed ourselves, whether we are Cleveland area or not. The Cleveland Browns, I feel like they are slowly flying under the radar. Granted, the Pittsburgh Steelers are undefeated right now, but the Browns are, what are they, 6-2, 6-3, something like that?
They barely beat the Texans, Mike. Damn!
Jared, stop it.
You're talking the Cleveland Browns are still – in any other, imagine you put them in the NFC least, they'd be running away with that division. But we're talking about the Cleveland Browns right now. There's still a lot of football to be played. Baker has, give that team a quarterback and they could have been undefeated at this point. I feel like the Baker hype is over. I was a big Baker man and jumped on the train. Dude has made more money. I see him more on TV in commercials than I see him actually playing football. But, you know, that is surprising to me, even though they're not the number one seed, essentially, in that division. They may not even make the playoffs, you know, based off that record. But to me, flying under the radar, well over 500, Kevin over there at the head coach, not letting us hear, but Stefanski. Yeah, going in and just taking over that team, getting things right. Let down. I don't know if this is a letdown, but I've got to put my Detroit Lions in a plug right here. Actually, to tell you the truth, at 4-5 or wherever they're at right now is still in the playoff hunt, even with the Green Bay Packers. But at this point, I don't – I guess more so I was a big Matt Patricia supporter, loved the guy. At this point, the letdown is that he's still in Detroit. He's still coaching. Granted, we're in the middle of the thick of things, and looking on the outside in the wild card, it'd be a long shot. We'd have to rip off the table. We're sitting pretty going to this Carolina game. No McCaffrey. Who knows what's going on with Teddy? Although Stafford's pretty banged up, but I just feel like I live and die by Cleveland and Detroit, and that's sad. That's what my life has come to in sports. Usually. Based off where we're at, I'm in Ohio, rooting for Detroit. Usually the next best thing would be, we'll root for the closest team. That'd be Cleveland. Well, granted, they're having a little better season. So, hey, maybe we'll root for Cincinnati. Blaine talked about Joe Burrow having a great season, but they've got two wins or whatever. Mix hasn't seen the field in 4 weeks or 5 weeks. Overall, I was going to talk about the Ravens, but I think that was pretty straightforward. But, Jared, you talked about Las Vegas. And being the surprise, Chucky, after the win last week in Arrowhead, their bus driver, did you hear about that, took them on a victory lap around the stadium, and Andy Reid was not happy about that because I guess the bus driver was a friend of Andy Reid's or something like that, and they made him do it. So that was great. But speaking of which, how do you think, before we transition, how do you think they're going to fare this week with their entire defense pretty much on the COVID list?
So it's weird. It's weird because the problem is with the Raiders is their defense kind of hangs there. They're not elite by any stretch. They're good, but they're not elite. It's the fact on offense they can control the clock with their style of play. They're not going to score on two plays. It's run the football 20 times, Josh Jacobs, and a seam route to Darren Waller or Nelson Aguilar, and that's their offense. And it's apparently so flawless that it works. So, I mean, yeah, half their defense might be on the COVID list this week, but also, first, every team has a team that just always gives them trouble. For Kansas City, this may be Oakland. Las Vegas. And Kyle Brandt said this today, and I wasn't about to jump to this yet. I was like, he said it was a pretty good quote. He goes, if they win on Sunday, we have a rivalry and a Super Bowl contender in the silver and black. I'm like, Super Bowl contender, long shot. Rivalry? Oh, no, I'll stamp that already. I think that Las Vegas has proven that with this rebuild, and I got to give a shout out to our girl Shannon Walsh, came on our show last night, the show that will be lost to my internet. He goes, they quietly did a soft rebuild and they loaded their team up in 2 years. Everyone made fun of John Gruden 2 years ago on draft night, including myself, and the team's good. So, I seriously think Las Vegas is a serious shot on Sunday. For all I know, they could get blown out because of this COVID shit. It doesn't matter. There's still nine games left in the season. And Kansas City, for some reason, this season, some games they look lights out, the best team in football, and then a week later, they look atrocious or sloppy. I don't know what it is. I don't know if they just don't care every other week. I don't know, but I'm really loving Las Vegas. I'm living with it right now.
I think it's going to be a close game. I don't think the Chiefs are going to lose to the Raiders again this year. They could meet up in the playoffs, and I'll say that again. I don't think they're going to lose to the Raiders again this year. Now, I do have to shout out the Raiders. Maurice Hurst, alumnus of my high school, does play for them. So I want to see them do well, but I just wanted to point that out. But, yeah, it's going to be interesting. It's going to be a good game. Also, before we let Blaine talk, Mike, I just want to say, you root for really, really shitty teams. I know you're a Toledo man. But if you ever need an FBS team that you want to root for, that doesn't I'm not going to make that joke. If you ever need another FBS team to root for, I usually say no bandwagoners, but I'll let you into Bama Nation, arms open. I'll give you a big old hug.
Kev, you just want to kiss his cousin, all right, man?
That,
come on.
That fake spike, that was, yeah.
I'm a bucket.
That's why I said if you need another. Also,
there's no room on the bandwagon fan for the Buckeyes. Yeah,
I don't want to get on that bandwagon. You should be. They're gonna be dead in the water in 3 years once Ryan Day has to start actually recruiting.
Oh no, Ryan Day is does not take his foot off the gas pedal, which is nice. And actually, to tell you the truth, that those recruiting classes there are still all right. Actually, I'm glad you bring up college football. But before we transition on to our next one, this episode here is brought to you by Invader Coffee. We talked about them last week. Really, really great company that we're a part of. Veteran-owned, certified organic. These guys are, like I said, veterans located in Austin, Texas. They literally know, they don't forget where they came from, and they hold their standards as high as they did while they were serving our country. These guys are true veterans. Great coffee. Drop this off. We've given some of this stuff out. I know you guys are, we're talking about you want some coffee. I'm going to be sending it that way. But appreciate them again being on board as far as Bell App Sound Off and the Bell App Podcast Network here. Check them out. What do you got, R2-D2 going on right now? Every time I pitch Invader Coffee, I hear something in the background. Jared Coffin last week, something. Jeez, oh, please. Anyways, Invader Coffee, visit them, invadercoffee.com. They're also on Instagram, Facebook. They do have a Twitter account, but I don't think they use Twitter. But either way, a great great company. Love working with these guys, veteran-owned out of Austin, Texas. Check them out. That is my plug there. Before we get into our sound off, I'm glad you guys are talking about college football.
We could also plug this too.
Oh yeah, there we go. Breck, we'll do that next episode. Don't you worry. Don't get too ahead
Christmas
of yourself.
Ale, baby. This thing's fire.
But before we get into our sound off, this is me. I'm gonna throw this in there. Does Jim Harbaugh make it to the end of the season?
Kev, you take lead on this one.
Yes, 100%. I think they don't want to deal with negotiating that buyout, which is going to be massive because he's the third highest paid college football coach in the country. They don't want to deal with
that. Sure.
They might roll until next year then, but they're not going to want to deal with negotiating a buyout, I do think. Because I also think this team has too much talent. What? The coaching, hypothetically, is too good to go winless this year. I'm not saying that they're going to be that good.
They got their first one, but still, they lost four in a row. And their worst loss in 60-something. You're talking about a pristine organization.
I don't like Harbaugh. I'm indifferent on Michigan. They never play in a national championship, so it doesn't really fucking matter. I'm never going to see them. Alabama smacked them around in the Citrus Bowl, I think. Michigan's irrelevant to me, so I don't have a reason to hate them, so you know I'm being unbiased. I do think he will make it to the end of the year.
I agree. Before we get to Blaine or Jared, I just feel, and Kevin actually touched on it, this year, COVID alone, with the loss in schools and the loss, actually, to tell you the truth, I think it was Tennessee. 8 staffers were asked to take a pay cut, and all 8 of them said, no, absolutely, we're not taking a pay cut. And that was in their contract. They didn't have to take a pay cut. But COVID alone has obviously decimated money for all organizations, for the NCAA. Well, I wouldn't say the NCAA because they don't collect up this, but institutions as far as colleges and stuff like that. I think to Kevin's point, they're not going to negotiate a buyout because one, you get rid of him, that entire coaching staff, you have to buy out essentially. You have to rehire new coaching staff during this kind of period. Hugh Freeze has been talked about for at least with Ole Miss, I think recently or something like that. With Muschamp, that's where they're at. Yeah. Either way. Yeah. But that's what I've heard. It's very difficult. I do think he'll make it through the season. And like Kevin said, I do think there's a very good opportunity. He's a Michigan guy, that he'll make it. He'll just ride with him. But to Kevin's point, he has not done anything special. Urban, granted, set the world on fire in Ohio State, was a great recruiter. But as far as Urban, as far as Harbaugh, you saw him in the pros and stuff like that working with quarterbacks, but he is a horrible recruit. He has not had a single quarterback outside of Shea Shea Patterson that transferred that has actually lived up to any hype whatsoever. So, yes, I see him making it to the end of the season. Blaine, what you got?
I agree. I think due to COVID, I think they don't move. They don't move on him. I think he's lost his motivation. You can see it on the sidelines. He's not a good recruiter. I'll second that too. We haven't seen a good recruit come out of there in forever. I just think he's lost his mojo. I don't think you can run any more YouTube videos or YouTube ads and sell yourself to basically be a good coach. I think his time is done at the end of the year. And to be honest with you, I would almost willingly be put on money line that if he continues to get blown out, yeah, the time it might change before that. But I still don't think they'll let them go because what Kevin said with his contract and everything.
To piggyback off what Blaine said, I think Harbaugh is already talking about, like, you already heard the whole thing about him wanting to go back to the NFL. New York Jets and Trevor Lawrence are pretty promising their pal. I could definitely see that being a mix. We already saw Harbaugh can succeed in the NFL. We saw with San Francisco, he made Colin Kaepernick look like an all-pro quarterback. Alex Smith, same thing. Comeback player of the year right there. With Michigan, it's just every year it's the same thing. Like, Kev always busts my stones about, oh, the U's back, the U's not back, whatever, or Texas, whatever. Michigan's even more of a joke than the two of those other programs because at least Texas and Miami stay semi-relevant.
Look at Kevin.
Where Michigan, oh my God, like 0-4? Are you serious? I get it's COVID year, but like, holy shit. Like, I think this is the year where, like, we always kind of heard things about Harbaugh, like, not fitting in Michigan. Like, he had that one great class with Rashawn Gary, but they're all gone now. I look at it like, I think he's already said, all right, I'm out after the end of this year. I'll bail. But it's just to me, like, I think it's just, he's going to tread water the rest of the season. They probably win 2-3 games, and that might just forego him. They're probably going to win next week. And that'll forgo him getting fired for 2 weeks.
They got Rutgers this weekend.
Oh, yeah. I swear to God, if they lose to Rutgers, then Harbaugh's done. He might as well just start
walking. What's the spread on that game?
It's got to be below 30.
Let me check. Both 1-3. The over-under is 55. And
wow.
Where the hell is it at?
No one said that. Rutgers -1.5.
I was going to say,
no. That's basketball. Why the fuck is this giving me basketball?
Oh, I almost lost my game. What?
For fuck's sake.
Rutgers are home?
Jesus.
I don't see a line on it outside of the over-under.
I think Vegas was like, yeah, we're not touching this.
That's from October.
Oh, here we go. No bet available.
Oh, my word. Wow.
This game is so bad. They didn't put a line on it.
Yeah. Based off of Yahoo.
How the mighty have fallen.
Yeah. The over-under is 55, but yeah, it says no bet available.
Over-under 55?
That's not even 7:30 game on Big Ten Network. So you want to see a monkey fuck football, turn that to game on.
Yeah. Jesus. DraftKings. BetMGM, FanDuel, PointsBet, SugarHouse, Bet365, Unibet, William Hill, and Bet America all are not giving a line for this game.
I said there's nobody. Yahoo is not either. That
Holy
might be
shit.
The first time.
Guys, we've had the first game where they're not even putting a line out for it. They've put lines out for D2 football games before.
So
what the hell?
Yeah.
If anyone's curious, most people are betting on Rutgers in this, 56%.
Because you can't,
for sure.
Yeah, I mean, you're talking
72% of people are betting the under.
Yeah. I would go with the under too.
I mean, yeah.
Unless they run some more trick plays, Rutgers, but I don't see that happening.
So Jared, place your bet. The over under is 55. Where are you at on that?
I'm taking the under and I'm taking Rutgers. I think this is like, I'm gonna throw a nod to my mom's home state university, but like, oh my God, like, I think Michigan's just burning. And it's, everyone's talking about Penn State. and how they're like having a rough year. I think Michigan's worse. Like the Big Ten this year, as much as Kev loves to rip me on my on the ACC, dude, the Big Ten's got to hit even harder this year. And so, I get it's COVID, but at the same time, like some things okay. you can't really no. knock COVID.
Mike, let me respond to this. Jared, Big Ten had so far to fall. Like a small fuck up in the gear will cause them to fall more than the ACC. Because out of Clemson and now Notre Dame, the ACC is garbage.
The rental Notre Dame.
Oh God.
He's just gonna drink beer.
Like Miami's 9-1. That's all you need to know about the ACC and how it is as a competitive.
They team. Lost. The only team they lost to is Clemson.
Yeah, and okay, that doesn't mean they're good.
They're still a top 15 team.
Unnecessarily so. You beat Virginia Tech by one. You should be out of the top 25. Mike Vick ain't there anymore, bud.
Ohio State was the top three team, and they didn't play a game for 5 weeks.
Yeah, so the Rangers are fucking stupid. I'm glad we could all agree.
That's man, a good point.
I'm so glad that we talked about Rutgers. Okay, so give me this. You guys still are all on board that if the Rutgers just trounce the shit out of Michigan, that Harbaugh, I mean, don't you think that the team would really – or the institution of the University of Michigan would have to contemplate just for the fans' sanity getting rid of Harbaugh.
So
if they lose to Rutgers, absolutely.
I don't think they will lose to Rutgers, but if they do, it's going to be Jim. Jim's the one at Michigan. I always get those two confused. Hey, Jim. Yeah, we're gonna buy you out. It's like, all right, I want $10 million out of my bag. Okay. All right, well, I want $20 million then. Okay.
I see ya.
Get out.
It's like Manny Diaz, man.
So let me ask this question. So who takes over?
Brady
Hoke. Back.
You lose to Rutgers, just get rid of the whole program. Throw it out.
Yeah, Shiano still there?
Go full SMU for 2 years. Just knock it out. We're done.
Exactly. Problem solved.
They're not beating Ohio State for 2 years. Who gives a shit?
Jesus. Anyways.
He is back at Rutgers.
I know, college. Yeah, Shiano.
Yeah, yeah.
I forgot about that.
Yeah.
So, anyways, moving on for college football because I know we can talk about college football forever with these guys. We're getting into our belly up sound off the whole point in the name. We talk about modern day events, sporting events, anything in general that appeases these guys that pops into their head. Blaine, we're gonna start with you. You should have known this was coming, so you should have something.
So, I do have a topic. So, 2021 Hall of Fame ballot. All right. So, if Barry Bonds doesn't make it in, I will go on an hour-long rant that steroids in baseball make it more exciting. Just let the dude in. You still have to hit a baseball.
Ask Robinson.
He was all around probably one of the best hitters, best home run hitters. Best power hitters, even though he went from 180 to 260, it doesn't matter. Just let him in. And then after that, go buy a Pete Rose shirt on our merchandise shop because you got a free Pete Rose.
What a transition right there.
Hey, Blaine, can you do me a favor?
Yeah.
If Barry Bonds does not get in the Hall of Fame next year, smile. Can you go on a Bobby Sands-esque hunger strike?
Hunger and greed don't go hand in hand.
Well, you got to explain that to me because I'm not understanding. But if you want me to go on a go on a hunger strike,
I do not want you to go on a Bobby Sands hunger strike. Bobby Sands was a member of the IRA, was arrested due to that, was a political prisoner, was not given political prisoner status, I think. I could be wrong. My sister probably knows more about this. He went on a hunger strike and died due to the hunger strike. They tried to force feed him. Wasn't working out. He died. Please don't actually do that.
Well, fine. I'll just make it. I'll lose 50 pounds. Okay.
Naked mile.
Yeah, we'll do that too. With my Manscaped boxers on.
Hey, man. I think my son's got a little socking put over your dinghy.
But let's just talk about it. Nick Swisher's on the Hall of Fame ballot with Barry Bonds. Just bang my head up against the wall. Please, bang my head up against the wall.
I love Nick Swisher, but that's not fair. Nick Swisher is better. Nick Swisher is a better commentator than he was a player. Let's be honest here.
Like, anyways, in terms of everybody that's on this list, like Nick Swisher does not belong.
How do you feel about Curt Schilling not being in?
Let him in.
I don't know if I'm being biased because I want him in.
The same thing, but that's a really tough decision for me because I don't like Curt Schilling as a person. So
I don't think anyone does.
But in terms of an actual pitcher, a baseball player, yes.
Okay, I actually have a Curt Schilling story real quick. But it does not involve him bankrupting the state of Rhode Island. So one of my former bosses used to pitch for the Red Sox, minor league guy, got called up, blew out his arm, spent the next couple years in the minors. But he pitched with Curt Schilling. He was on the Red Sox at that time. And I used to work at baseball fields, and that's what my boss did too. And Curt Schilling came up one day. He's like, "Oh, Curt, how are you?" Curt Schilling's like, "Who the fuck are you? Why are you talking to me?" So, Curt Schilling, by all accounts, asshole. Daughter's very attractive, though, from what I've been told.
So is Wayne Gretzky. Jared,
I'm surprised we didn't even talk about Dustin Johnson and Paulina Gretzky. Man.
Anyways, Jared, before you fall asleep, what do you got?
Oh, man. I got to throw out a little bit of one of those, like, so, like, today, I was having a decent day. I was working a lot today, but I got sent a tweet. I guess Logan Ryan called out Philadelphia after the game. It was talking about how the Giants were so prepared and the Eagles looked so unprepared. And they looked like the Giants were such a better team. And I thought to myself for a minute, because I watched that game. I was generally pretty sober for that game. I watched every painstaking snap with a Giants fan, which was just appallingly painful. Buddy, I love your enthusiasm, but you've been the third best corner on every team you've played for. On top of that, you made one play the entire damn game. You were getting cooked by Richard Rodgers. And two, as much as my Eagles played like shit, you were two drop passes and a bad defensive coverage and a bad pass from Daniel Jones that got caught from losing that game, or at least tying that game. I am all for teams getting on their high horse after beating a division rival. That is just how sports trash talk goes. But when it's a 10-point game, when it comes down to the other team making so many damn mistakes in their play calling, defensive schemes, and route running ability, that's why you lose. It's not like the Giants defense basically is like, "Oh, you're going to fuck up. Okay, we're just not going to screw up because of it." I tried to explain this on our show yesterday. It wasn't because of the Giants being that good. It was because Philadelphia was asleep the first half. And then the second half, they basically decided in the fourth quarter, "Yeah, fuck it, we're done." And that's why everyone was pissed. I think the Eagles coaching was atrocious anyway, but like, honestly, that I got sent that quote by three different Giants fans today because I live in Giants country, and I'm just like, guys, you are morons. Just as dumb as Logan Ryan. I'm sorry. His best career moment was picking off his former teammate in the playoff game. Let's be honest.
All right, Kev, what's your take? Sound off. What you got for tonight?
I actually have two. One of them's a brief plug, and another one's something that's going to piss off Jared.
Ooh, even better.
Number one.
Perfect.
Download the Collide app again. We've done two games in it now. We're doing Browns Eagles this Sunday at 1:00. Is that the time, Jared?
Yeah, 1:00 Browns Eagles.
I don't know if it was 1:00.
Browns also just lost players to COVID. So,
and then we're doing Eagles Seahawks next weekend. So getcollide.com. Check it out. It's a lot of fun. It's last weekend. It was Eagles fans only. I don't know why the fuck they had me there. I'm not an Eagles fan. I don't hate myself that much. It's not – we got rid of that. We negotiated. It's anyone who wants to come in, chat, some NFC least versus some AFC North. I don't know why you would want to, but you can do it. And then also, Justin Herbert is not winning Rookie of the Year.
Oh, well, we know that. Tua's making his case.
No, he had a chance.
Pretty well.
This week, today, is the reason why. And I'll tell you. Have you ever heard the story?
No haircut by a strength and conditioning coordinator.
God damn it, Mike. You guys ever hear the story of Samson?
Oh, my God.
Yes. He's a biblical figure. He was basically the Jewish version of Hercules, is what they believe. And he could perform superhuman feats. He could fight lions, take on armies of men. He massacred an entire army of Philistines using only the jawbone of a donkey, however. But all his power came from his hair. And then
they cut it off.
The Philistines paid his his booty call, Delilah, to cut off his hair while he slept. He lost all his power. So I think Justin Herbert's power came from his hair, and now he's not going to win Rookie of the Year. He's going to suck the rest of the way.
Wow.
Well, as one of Justin Herbert's flow bros, I am very offended he cut his hair. I saw that this morning.
Awful,
I was very sad.
It looks
terrible. No. And the fact that this dude still has acne because he's so freaking young.
Face kid.
Oh, my God. It looks bad. I'm like, dude, you got to keep the hair, man.
That COVID gentlemen. Cut.
Oh, God. No COVID cuts.
Preparing
I haven't had a haircut since even, like I think since we started Sound Off.
Do you think that you could bring that that conversation into Clyde this weekend?
Yeah. Like about Samson or
no, not Samson. The personal value of what it would take for two haircuts.
Too far off topic. Let's end this on a
$2 million.
Let's take us out on behalf of Belly Up Sound Off, former Duke, and Blaine. Again, I appreciate you guys being a part. Download the Clyde app, like Kev and Jared said. They'll be on this week. They'll be a part of the Eagles-Browns game, which Kev got roped into the Eagles fan, so whatever, he's kind of screwed. And as far as Invader Coffee, appreciate them being a part of the show and being a part of our network. We'll see you guys next week. In general, thanks for tuning in, and hopefully we'll see you guys on Clyde on Sunday. Have a good night.
Bye. She just moved to LA, go to UCLA, and she drive a Maserati, then she got a body, she be trying to party, she be trying to party. She just moved to LA, go to UCLA, and she drive a Maserati, then she got a body, she be trying to party, she be trying to party. Sometimes you gotta lose somebody. To find you really love someone, ooh. And I do, and I do, and I do, yeah. Sometimes you gotta lose somebody just to find you really love someone, ooh. See me tryna party. She just moved to LA. Fall so hard, motherfuckers wanna find me. First nigga gotta find me. What's 50 grand to a motherfucker like me? Can you please remind me? Fall so hard, this shit crazy. Y'all don't know that those shit fade. Nets can go 0-82 when I look at you like this shit crazy. Fall so hard, this shit weird. We ain't even pro be here. Fall so hard since we here. It's only right that we be fair. Psycho, I'm libo, go Michael. Take a pick, Jackson, Tyson, Jordan, game 6.